Welcome to the People's Church Divine Prophecy. My name is Reverend Judi and I would like to welcome you to the church. Please stand. And we will go ahead and light the candles. And Miss Suzanne, can I call on you? Surprise?
Sure. Yeah. Surprise. Not really good with these lighters, but we'll give it a try.
Symbolizing the mind, body, and spirit. Thank you. And we are all here. Wonderful, wonderful. Please join me in an attitude of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the blessings of this amazing and beautiful spring day. Thank you for the joy, the love, the laughter, the light, and the lessons that will be gifted to each of us. Thank you for the opportunity to congregate as one. One heartbeat, together in sync, listening and learning. Walk with us, open our hearts, and fill us with your joy. We ask this in your precious name. Amen. Amen. Well, it's nice to see some new faces, so welcome everyone, and it's always lovely to see our returning faces and faces that might not have been here just recently. So anyway, we'd like to see everyone. Just a quick reminder to please shut off your cell phones, because generally God calls when we're together. That's just the way it is. And if you use the facilities around the corner to the left, to the left. It's time now to move into our message from the pastor. So please help me in welcoming our pastor, Reverend Steve Adkins.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. All the people that have been coming, those that are coming back, and it's a great energy here today. I guess this past week, a lot of what's come to me is, why do we have to have challenges in our life? Usually those days come when it's just one right after the other. There's no let up in it, there's no break in it. Sometimes it goes on for days, sometimes it goes on for weeks. I remember one time a group I was trying to get sober with, and I did, and I'm still sober today. They had a saying, they asked you, what's the worst thing that could ever happen to you in your life? And of course, everybody had death, sickness, someone you know died that you care about. And the response was, nothing at all. If nothing at all ever happens to you, you will stay exactly how you are now and never progress. So the challenges in your life, some of them are spirit-guided through your spiritual advancement. Some of them we kind of bring on ourselves. But some of them are put there by divine purpose that are indispensable to our development on this path. Sometimes it's hard to tell the difference. But the bottom line of it all is that challenges have to be in your life in order for you to move and change. Life changes all around you, and if you don't meet those challenges, life passes you by. The world moves past you, and you just find yourself stuck where you're at with nothing going on. There's another saying that I remember, a path that doesn't have any rocks in it usually doesn't lead anywhere worth going. So you have to take these challenges as they come to you and look at what's coming down the path, not just what's right there in front of you. And as I said, sometimes it's not necessarily debilitating or that life changing. It's just the things you have to do, just a lot of little things all day long, one right after the other. And if you understand that these things are there for your betterment, sometimes you can get through a little better, sometimes you can't, but you just keep pushing until you hit the end of the road, until you hit another challenge or another path to take. So this past week for me has been pretty busy. I've had a lot of things going on at the job. I'm trying to get me to do go overseas. I've had a lot of things with my son. He's been trying to move into a house we've been building for about 2 years to get him into it. So he's finally in it, spent his first night in it last night. So there's a lot of effort, but a lot of good things happened at the end of that effort yesterday. I guess the biggest thing about challenges is once you get by them, take a moment to sit and enjoy getting by them. Take a moment to feel that calm of a challenge coming to a conclusion. Because if you just keep moving challenge to challenge, you get frustrated and you get tired of meeting challenges. So take a time, just take time to say, I'm going to just take a time out now. There's no problem so big that it can't wait till tomorrow. So, and I don't mean a lot of tomorrows, but you know, just sometimes say that to yourself. Today is my day. I'm not doing anything today that I want to do. I'm just going to take the time out and just go somewhere. So enjoy yourself at the end of the challenges and realize that challenges most of the time are not self-inflicted. Sometimes they're spirit-guided. So I just ask you to think of these things and just meet each day with a smile if you can. Thank you.
Please, everyone stand and we'll go ahead and sing a song.
Let's sing In the Garden. That's hymn number 4. We're going to do the first 2 verses of In the Garden, number 4.
Inhale And exhale, allow yourself to relax. Allow your body to settle into the chair in complete comfort. Put your hands in an open position. And be. Be in this space. of energy, as in the earth. You feel all elements of life surrounding and lifting you. They're drawing you to them. You continue forward, as magnetically pulled to the oneness. The oneness of life. The life force of all. It's calling to you. You continue forward, and ahead you see a bright light like no other that you've ever seen before. It continues to draw you. You feel the love pulling you. As you continue closer and closer and closer, find yourself standing beside the most brilliant light and heartbeat of love that you have ever experienced. My child, you have come. You have come as you have been called. Welcome. Of life, for the beginning of love, for all life forces and energies surround and lift and are within you. You, my child, are perfect. Do not carry unburdened desires, worries, and concerns upon self any longer. This is for me. This is for me. You came back to the earth to live, to love, to be, and to experience all that can possibly be. This is not without lessons. Some call them challenges. Some call them gifts. A different path to walk upon. Each one is a blessing. Sometimes in human form, you worry and you carry concerns and burdens of being imperfect. That is not imperfect. It is just being a human. This is what you went to be, and you are forward. stairs and turn and wave once again to the brilliant light that's behind you, and you know the truth for what it is. The essence of all life force is now within you, deeply rooted, as it was directed to you. Start down the stairs, through the lavender, down through the blue, down to the green, through the yellow stair, beautiful rainbow. Continue down through the orange and the red. Continue down as the golden light shimmers down and around you, and you find yourself entering into your body once again. Settle into a chair. Allow yourself to take a deep breath. Inhale and exhale. Inhale and exhale. Wiggle your fingers and toes and find yourself seated. Find yourself seated and open your eyes once again. Welcome back. Welcome back. Amen. Amen. Please stand and we'll sing another song. Ms. Mari, how would you like to ground this, my dear?
Oh, let's wheel and rock and stomp a little. How about I've got the joy, joy, joy? That's hymn number 11. I got the joy, joy, joy. Of course, you know People's Church. You're the other half of the music. So, hymn number 11, People's Church. Give me a beat.
Today I'm going to speak about different modes of healing. This past couple of weeks I've had a number of people call me out of the blue and want me to start doing distance healing on them. And it started moving me back into what I really love to do about this work. I do mediumship okay, but I really enjoy the healing. And in the intro it said that I was a physical healer. There's two different kinds of spiritual healing. There's physical and mental. I'm primarily a physical healer. I work with cancers, tumors, blood-borne diseases, nervous system disorders, that kind of thing is where I have most of my success. It doesn't mean I can't have successes in the other areas, but the particular energy that I work with works best on physical ailments. There's two different kinds of healing that people use in today's world. One's magnetic and one's spiritual. Magnetic is generally the first aid to spiritual healing. It's where somebody generates their own body's energy and causes a curative effect by touching people. You see it with mothers and their children. You see it with friends consoling people going through mourning or difficult times. They touch them, immediately there's a calmness there. That tends to be more magnetic than spiritual. There's nothing wrong with it. It just doesn't last very long. And if you do a continual effort of magnetic healing throughout the day on people, and that's your tendency, it tends to deplete your body's energy, and you have to recharge it through meditation and through exercise to build that back up within you. And if done too long without recharging, it can cause cellular damage to your body. And they've done studies on spiritual healers, and they found, and mediums, and found that there's an extremely high rate of diabetes and leukemia within them. And that's based on doing too much of that kind of work without taking time to take care of your own body. And usually the effects of magnetic healing aren't lasting. It's not a complete curative effect. It's a short-term type of thing. But again, there's a place for it and a need for it. So if you have that ability, don't shy away from using it. Spiritual healing, and this is how I believe about spiritual healing, and it's not the only way to believe, it's not the correct way to believe, it is a way to believe. This is how I understand it. This is how I work with that energy. It's kind of like people arguing about which style of martial arts is better. Well, it depends strictly on the practitioner, not the style of martial arts that you're doing. And this is the same way with healing. It depends on the practitioner and their dedication to their craft, their dedication to their spiritual philosophy, and how they maintain that trust with the spirit through that philosophy and belief. My belief is that prior to birth, a matrix, a spiritual matrix, is generated in the mother's womb. And this matrix has connecting points to the flesh. And I guess if you were to see it in a two-dimensional drawing, it looked kind of like a geodesic dome with connecting points to different areas of the physical. As the conception takes place, the biological flesh grows over this matrix and is then generated into a physical form through the act of the mother and the gift of birth. As this child grows into adulthood and you begin to become active and have your own sense of reason, what happens is as you react to different things, let's say shock, the suddenness of change in your life, these kinds of things, if it goes into an unresolved repetitive thought, that thought generates into that spiritual matrix and causes a weakness within the spiritual matrix. And that point of connection to the flesh is where the illness begins to manifest. And it's not that you're thinking yourself sick, like I've heard some people say. What it is if I have a chart that I use in my spiritual healings that's generated over 200 years of spiritual healing. They take different areas of trauma, and specific areas of the body are affected by repetitive thought. And an example of that is if you're having trouble with one-on-one relationships, it tends to affect your feet and the small of your back. So let's say you're having trouble with a relationship, a repetitive thought, unresolved thought of sorts, and it can be a tribal relationship, a lawsuit, a church, anything like that that you're having difficulty with in a relationship fashion, it will weaken those areas through weakening the spiritual matrix connection to the flesh. You step out your front door that has a little step on it, you stepped out 1,000 times, and then suddenly, by the weakening of that, you step off and you twist your ankle. So it's not that you're thinking yourself ill, but the weakening of that connection between the flesh and the spiritual causes that to happen. And it's much more in depth with that, because the chart that I use goes all the way in, you know, it covers all the major areas of the body with specific types of thought. So these are how people create illnesses within themselves. In response to this, whatever you believe is a creative spirit, God, whatever you want to call the oversoul, the greater spirit of all mankind, the creative spirit in the universe, this spirit senses that distress in that person and then sends an emissary to that person. That person is then needs to have an introduction made between them, whether you believe in angels, spirit guides, or just spirit beings helping people on the earth plane. A healer such as myself senses that spirit and then makes the connection from the spirit to the physical, making that, that spirit able to work with that person in that condition. So after my sessions, they don't have to keep coming back to me time after time. Once that introduction is made, the spirit and that person have a certain amount of time they go through a relationship with. And as that, that relationship evolves, sometimes they may need to come back after 6 months or something like that to give another connection to it. And that's how I believe that spiritual healing works. And I, as a quote healer, only make that connection, make that introduction. I'm not the source of the power. I'm not the power. All I do is make the connecting link between the unseen and the seen and make it known and usable. You can also see that the Bible itself talks about two deaths in the body, the spiritual death and then the physical death follows. And this is similar to what I'm talking about here. As the spirit weakens, the physical body weakens also with it. People don't pay enough attention to that and end up being so caught up in the physical that they just keep driving their body into more and more difficulty. There's also a lot of misconceptions about healing. I was working with one woman and she asked me to put somebody on the list and she says, don't you have to have permission from their spirit to heal them? And I said, no, that's not really how I believe it works. I don't have to have permission at all. I said, I'm working spirit to spirit, so it's not me working with that person on the physical plane. The truth is always a truth. It doesn't get altered from condition to condition. So how would people in a coma or how would children that aren't familiar with this consciously in their mind get healing if they hadn't given permission before you work with them? So there, this business about having somebody's permission to heal them is not correct because it's done on a spiritual level and the spiritual interaction works with that person for the higher and best purpose. So you're not really interfering with their life. And I remember an example of that. As a healer, I don't try to conclude a result. I don't sit there and think, I want this to happen for my healing. And I learned that. There's a group called Harry Edwards Healing Sanctuary in the UK that I worked with for a while. And they believe that natural healing is the best way to heal. And when I was working with this one person, this woman had brought her husband to me, and he had had some kind of operation on his head, and part of his brain was atrophied, and he was beginning to exhibit basic signs of Alzheimer's. And he was forgetting things. And the whole story is that this guy had started a pharmaceutical company and his whole family worked there. And all of his relatives worked there, not just his immediate family, but hundreds of people worked there and depended on him. And he refused to give up control of the organization because he'd forget that he did things, he'd forget to do things, and he'd forget where keys were. He just kept forgetting a lot of things. So his wife brings him to me and she says, I want his memory back. I said, well, I don't know if I can get his memory back or not, but we'll see what happens. So I started working with him, and during the process, I was given an intuitive thought that she is also very estranged by it, not just because of the actions, but she was losing her love for him. So I started working with her, and then I started doing a dual session with them both in the room at the same time, and they fell in love again. And he never regained his memory, but he stopped needing to be in control because he felt safe, he felt secure by being in love again. And that was the spiritual purpose, not him regaining his memory. So if I'd have been concentrating on giving him back his memory, I would have been putting something in the mix that was contrary to what the spirit intended for that man's life and that couple's life as well. So when you heal, you have to heal with the intention of the highest and best occurring. You can, and when I heal, I think about the condition of the person so that there's a focal point for the spirit to work with. The spirit, it's kind of like them, it's kind of like when you dunk your head down in a pool of water and open your eyes, you hear and see about like they hear and see this side. So it takes an intermediary to create, to ask for intercession for healing for people most of the time. You can do it by groups or by individuals. But it takes an intermediary, a quote healer on this side, to create that intercession. There has to be an intercession, there has to be an instrument to transfer that intercession, and there has to be spirit involvement, because without spirit, there's no lasting healing, like I said before. It's only a temporary healing, it's a magnetic healing. And when the spirit intercedes, nothing is there's nothing that can't be done. Spiritual healing can change cellular structure, it can change bone structure, it can straighten arthritic limbs, it can do almost anything that needs to be done, because it's on a higher plane of existence. And this higher plane of existence, to the spiritualist faith, which is what I am as a spiritualist, healing demonstrates proof that there is a God, a creative spirit over all of creation, by being able to change cellular structure. The human science, the human medical field cannot change cellular structure. All that they can do, they do a lot of great things, but they can't change cellular structure. So that shows a dominating intelligence over all of creation, and it also demonstrates the fact that this intelligence is beneficial, is benevolent towards this world. It's not antagonistic, it's not punishing, it's not detrimental. It's a beneficial and acts in a very positive fashion towards the people of this world and this creation. So there's a couple of things that, as I said, this demonstrates along with the dynamics of spiritual healing. The other part of healing that's greatly overlooked a lot of the times is the healing power of your physical body. Your physical body and its instrument has such a tremendous power of healing that has absolutely nothing to do with the spirit realm or magnetic healing. Self-healing is just amazing when you can tie into it and make it work. I remember back when I was about 18, I was working at Disney, the first phase when it was nothing but mud lots in a contemporary hotel, and I had my little finger was cut off through both knuckles in a construction accident. And the ball of the joint was completely destroyed, but the finger was still hanging on by two little pieces of flesh. So I wrapped it up in a t-shirt and got sent to Orlando, and the doctor there's wanted me given permission to finish amputating the little pieces of flesh. And I said, I'm not going to do that. So he hits me with this big painkiller, and he's still trying to get me to sign off on it as I'm going off into the ether. I wouldn't sign off on it. So I come back, and he had taken a metal rod and put it right down through the middle and put the pieces of finger back on there. And he kept telling me, he says, the ball of the joints will destroy both joints. It'll never grow back. That never grows back. The ball of the joint cannot grow back. I've been a surgeon for 40 years and it can't grow back. I said, well, you just put it back together and you let me worry about that. So it was really funny because back then I was a pure hedonist. I drank a lot, raised a lot of hell, and didn't much care about anything but day-to-day events. But I was stubborn as hell. It's a genetic tendency in our family. So I was just bound and determined and convinced that it was going to heal itself. And he kept telling me, you know, if that started going gangrenous, you're going to lose half your hand. I said, Doc, just ride with it and see what happens. So about 4 weeks later, I go in for a checkup, and he took an x-ray. And he brings this x-ray out. I wished I had got a copy of it, but again, I was pretty wild back then. I didn't care too much about stuff like that. And it showed a phantom image of a ball of a joint in both joints regrowing right in between the bone ends. And he said, I've never witnessed a miracle before my eyes. I said, let me just witness a pure Adkins stubbornness. I said, I told you all the news in that finger. So bottom line is your body has a tremendous healing ability within it. When you become convinced of that fact with unwavering conviction. So it's not a matter of belief or faith, it's just unwavering conviction that that's going to heal itself. And I remember I saw a TV special. This guy had an injury a motorcycle injury, and the whole calf muscle was gone. Somehow it had been destroyed in the wreck. The bone was still there, and the foot was still there, but the entire calf muscle was gone. And the doctors were getting ready to amputate it, and he had called in a guy that was, he called him a mesmerist, not a hypnotist, but a mesmerist. And Anton Mesmer was the guy that developed the forerunner of hypnotism. Mesmerism is not exactly the same thing. Mesmerism is used to stimulate cells and to make healing occur, but generally is what it's used for nowadays. So this guy goes in there, and he wouldn't let any cameras in there. And after about 6 weeks, the calf muscle started regenerating itself. So there's another example of working with the human body to have it regenerate itself. Just the physical healing power of the body. And the other thing is most of you know, that I was in a pretty bad wreck last July on my own motorcycle. Had a traumatic brain injury over the whole right side of my head, bleeding on the inside. And they told my boss at work, he said, just get your replacement ready because he's not coming back. He's not coming back. He's going to be in his hospital for 2 to 3 months. Easy. And then he's leaving in a wheelchair. 3 weeks later, I walked out of the hospital, thanks to the healing of the church and people, as well as again my old man Ken Stubbornness of just not accepting the conditions that were being explained to me. So these are the things that you can do of your own accord. He came in after 3 weeks. He says, I can't believe I got to let you go. He said, your head's 99% healed. I said, you mean I'm good and solid? Mentally stable? He says, yeah. I said, all right, I got a professional opinion about that now. Yeah, disappoint a lot of people, I can tell you. But it's all about attitude. It's what you do, how you do things. I mean, if you look around your life, you can see those things about attitude. And I'm not saying ignore doctors' advice. They base their opinions on group results. They don't base them on individual results. And you as an individual have a choice of attitude about these things. You have the right, you have the choice of completely submitting yourself or staying in charge, staying, making the decision. Listen to them, pay attention to them when it makes sense, but still bring in your own consciousness. And again, I keep telling you, it's that old Adkins stubbornness, it's genetic. My mom had a crippling stroke at age 60. She's 90 now. And it paralyzed the whole right side of her body from smoking. She used to smoke like a chimney. And she immediately quit smoking, refused to sit in a wheelchair, and within a year was completely recovered. And she was completely paralyzed on the right side of her body when it started. So again, it's that attitude, that bringing up that internal healing ability of your own body, that determination to be well and be better. We have an example of that in our own congregation here. Florence Nordquist had her leg amputated from mid-thigh down. And last week she's in the gym doing recuperative exercises. A week later, at 90, was she 90? 90,
she was 95, almost
96. 96 years old. And within a week, she's out of bed and doing exercises. So again, it's attitude and intention. But if you get into serious spiritual issues, like I said, spiritual healing can heal anything. The last thing I'll tell you about is an example. Somebody had, well, two real quick ones. One of the mediums in Casadega was taking thyroid medication, and every 5 years they have to have some kind of medication given to them that knocks their health down so they can see the reaction of the drug. And it debilitates them, it makes them really tired a lot when this goes on. So one of the mediums asked me to give her healing. And I started sending her distance healing. And she calls me about 3 days later. She said, you're going to have to stop sending me healing. I said, why is that? She says, well, the drug's not working. It's not going to help down the line. They can't do the tests. So that spiritual healing is kind of interesting about how it works. And the other thing was the same person had a cousin who had constant fluid at the base of her spine, at the top of her spine, in the back of her head, and it just kept filling up in there, and then every 2 or 3 weeks they'd draw it out. And she asked me to put her on the healing list, so I did. And again, there was a good spiritual connection there. It's not me, it's just me making the connection. And this spirit that was working with her and it started making it go away, and it went completely away after about a month. So there's no limit to spiritual healing. But again, there's the difficulty, there's personal responsibility. One woman came to me for healing of a cancer that was wrapped all around her intestine and was inoperable. So I meditated at a distance for about a month. It started getting better. She came in person. I did healing on her, and it went completely away after about another 3 weeks, 3 more sessions in person. And she was smoking. She was still smoking. And I said, you know, you're going to have to quit smoking. I said, your body has gotten completely intolerant of tobacco. I'm not giving you health back here. I'm telling you, as an individual, your body has gotten completely reactionary with tobacco. You need to stop. So she goes back up where she comes from, 2 or 3 states away, and the cancer remanifested in another area, and she ended up dying from it. She wouldn't quit smoking. So even though spiritual healing can create tremendous things, you as an individual, through repetitive thought on the spiritual matrix, can cause it to remanifest. So there's a responsibility there. It's not this silver bullet, this cure-all that never comes back. You are responsible for what goes on with yourself and your body. So I just ask you to think about these things and try doing some self-healing on yourself. As I talked about, the ability to try to heal yourself. And the biggest stumbling block with that is being able to be objective about yourself and impersonal with what's going on with you. Because that's what it takes to make spirit connect. You have to be emotion-free, you have to be impersonal, and you have to be pretty connected to your meditation. And that's really hard to do with yourself. It really is. Doing spiritual healing. Now, the personal healing energy that I was talking about, that's more determination and attitude. But spiritual healing on yourself is a whole different thing to do. And I think I'm about 50% effective with it, if I were to be honest, about doing it to myself. Keep trying, keep working with it, and eventually these things work. But it's just wonderful to think about the gift of healing being given to all creation through the spiritual beings. You know, they're there, they love you, they want you to be healthy, they want you to be well. And it's up to us to tap into that and take their guidance, take their encouragement. And we get it all the time. We get these thoughts, these inspirations, but most of the time, I don't pay attention to them. It's just like this morning, I buy donuts every morning for the church, and I always like to get these maple ice creams. There were 2 maple ice creams there, and I was first in line, and I asked for a cup of coffee, which I don't normally ask for. And they're saying, get the maple ice, because they're going to go if you don't get them. And I didn't, and they went. So if you like making ways towards, I'm the reason they're not there. But it's like I said, you get these intuitive hits, these intuitive thoughts about the smallest things to the biggest things in your life. And it's up to you to act on them. And they're not going to stop giving them to you because you don't act on them. But you're not going to get the benefit of it if you don't. So just think of these things, realize that God loves you. God acts in a benevolent fashion towards you, not a punishing fashion. I think we do enough of that to ourselves without God having to get involved in it. And just love life. Love where you're at. And even if you're not in a perfect state of health, pick out what's good about your health. Positive pitch yourself about what is good and build good to good rather than bad to good. And you'll find a lot better benefit with that. Thank you for listening.
Thank you. That was lovely. That was very, very nice. I feel like we went to class. Thank you. Well, now it's time to go ahead.